Watch the Prince of Glory guide my richest gain. I count but loss and pour contempt on all my pride. See from his head, his hands, his sorrow and love flow mingled down. Did ever such love and sorrow meet, or thorns compose so rich a crown?
Good evening, everyone. Good evening. Welcome to our Good Friday service. The service will be laid out similar to what you see on Sunday morning. Everything you need is going to be on the screen. What we'd like you to do right now is rise for our two opening worship songs. So please rise.
Yeah.
Gracious Heavenly Father, we pray. Lord Jesus, thank you. I thank you that as you wrestled in the Garden of Gethsemane, seeking a way maybe out of what needed to happen, you said to the Father, "Not my will, but thine be done." That you are our substitute, that you are our Savior, our Redeemer. Holy Spirit, we ask you to fill this room. And not just the room, we ask you to fill every heart and mind that's here, that we might experience the crucifixion anew, that we might experience it once again with greater meaning, deeper and wider understanding of your love for us. And all God's people said, please be seated. So here are some selected readings from the four Gospels pulled together as one narrative of the Passion of Jesus. When they came to the place called the Skull, there they crucified him along with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they're doing." Pilate had a notice prepared and fastened it to the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this sign, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and the sign was written in Aramaic, Latin, and Greek. Chief priests of the Jews protested to Pilate, "Do not write 'the King of the Jews,' but that this man claimed to be King of the Jews." Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." When they crucified Jesus, they took him into four shares, one for each of them, with the undergarment remaining. This garment was seamless, woven in one piece from top to bottom. "Let's not tear it," they said to one another. This happened that the scripture might be fulfilled, which said, "They divided my garments among them and cast lots for my clothing." So this is what the soldiers did. It was the third hour when they crucified him. The people stood watching, and the rulers even sneered at him. They said, "He saved others, let him save himself. If he's the Christ of God, the chosen one." The soldiers also came up and mocked him. They offered him wine vinegar and said, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." Two robbers were crucified with him, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by hurled insults at him, shaking their heads and saying, "You who are going to destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, come down from the cross if you are the Son of God." In the same way, the chief priests, the teachers of the law, and the elders mocked him. "He saved others," they said, "but himself, he's the King of Israel. Let him come down now from the cross and we will believe in him. He trusts in God. Let God rescue him now if he wants him, for he said, 'I am the Son of God.'" One of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him. "Aren't you the Christ? Save yourself and us." But the other criminal rebuked him. "Don't you fear God," he said, "since you are under the same sentence? We are punished, but this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." Jesus answered him, "I tell you the truth, today you will be with me in paradise." Near the cross of Jesus stood his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother there and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, "Dear woman, here is your son." And to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that time on, this disciple took her into his house. From the sixth hour until the ninth hour, darkness came over all the land. About the ninth hour, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of those standing there did this, they said, "He's calling Elijah." Later, knowing that all was now complete, so that the scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, when he had received the drink, Jesus called out with a loud voice, "It is finished." Finally, Jesus said, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." And when he had said this, he breathed his last. At that moment, the curtain of the temple tore in two from split. The tombs broke open, and the bodies of many holy people who had died were raised to life. They came out of the tombs, and after Jesus' resurrection, they went into the holy city and appeared to many people. When the centurion and those with him who were guarding Jesus saw the earthquake and all that had happened, they were terrified and exclaimed, "Surely he is the Son of God." This is the word. Let's sing our message song.
Through the
worship team. Thank you. Is that an awesome song or what? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, bless the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts. May they be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. In Jesus' name, amen. If I can find a text, the text would be from the Gospel of John. The ninth said, I thirst. And so they gave him a sponge full of vinegar, and he drank it. And then, with a loud voice, he said, Tetelestai, it's finished. It's finished. If I do my job tonight, that phrase will have, I hope, deep meaning for you. Brothers and sisters in Christ, we've been for weeks now looking at the life of Jesus. When he was born into this world, although he is lowly in a manger, shepherds got to see heaven open up and angels singing to them about a Savior who had been born, a son of David. And then at 2 years old, there were some magi who came to visit Jesus. They were following this star for 2 years. They get to Jerusalem, and because of the spiritual darkness in that city for 2 years, and all of a sudden lose the object that you're following. So they go to Herod. He's the king, hasn't had a child. And so he asks for the Jewish teachers and the religious leaders to let him know what prophecy in the Old Testament talks about a Savior coming. And we talked about the fact that, and we saw that they immediately knew that from the book of Micah, there was this verse that said that out of Bethlehem, out of Judah, would come a Savior. Leave the city to go to Bethlehem, no one follows. Not one religious leader goes. Right there, we begin to see the focus of what we've done over the last several weeks about these two kingdoms. See, Jesus came to say that the kingdom of God is at hand. John the Baptist even preceded him with the saying that you guys are all born in this kingdom, but you're born again into this kingdom. There are two kingdoms. We're not in this kingdom trying to sprinkle a little bit of Jesus in, but Jesus says if you're going to be in that kingdom, you have to be born again. Dead bones have to come to life. Stone hearts have to beat again. We find Jesus baptized at 30 years old, and he begins his ministry. And the first thing he does is beeline it out to the desert. First thing he does after he is baptized is go out into the desert for 40 days and 40 nights. He doesn't eat anything. That doesn't matter as much as why he beelined out to the desert. He went to go nose to nose with the enemy. He went to go nose to nose with the enemy of that kingdom. And three times the enemy of that kingdom tried to trick him up and try to get him to sin. He quoted God's word. He was clear as and precise as could be, and he finally had to leave him. People bringing their children and bringing the sick and bringing them, and he would have compassion on them and he would heal them, and the next day he would teach and he would preach about the kingdom of God. How many parables begin with the kingdom of God is like? Jesus is trying to get us to understand that that kingdom is going to end. And only one is going to remain. So the question for every one of us is, which kingdom do we belong in? And the funny thing is, he doesn't appreciate one out. We've seen Jesus walk on water. Heck, we've seen Peter walk on water. What Jesus begins to tell us is that if we truly begin to understand what it means to live in this kingdom, we can have sharper senses, sharper hearing, sharper understanding, and we can even perform and do things just as Jesus did. Jesus himself says, "Greater things will you do than I have done." See, the Holy Spirit that dwells within you and within me is the very force and power, the very individual strength. So we should expect to see healings. We should expect to see lives transformed. We should expect to see blind people see. We should expect to see cancer gone. We should expect to see these things. Everything changes this last week of Jesus' life. Palm Sunday till today, Good Friday. You might mistake it if you're not paying attention. And so part of what I want to do today is make sure that we're seeing the right thing. We don't see Jesus healing anyone except for a guy's ear that Peter cuts off tonight. But we see that he's absolutely in control. We see that he is perceiving something that no one else sees. The Bible tells us that he set his face towards Jerusalem. Like flint, like a compass going north. Everything else was done and all the ministries were done, and now he's beelining it to Jerusalem because it's time for the Passover. And as we're looking at the hustle and bustle, as we're looking at Jesus riding on the colt of a donkey, as we're looking at how he's controlling all of that, we're watching people, "Hosanna to the Son of David, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." We see him cleanse the temple. We see him take it over Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. He takes over the whole temple. Over and they're spitting on him and blind him and cursing him out and it just seems to be chaotic. Some might even say that Jesus looks like and appears to be a victim, but I'm here to tell you that he's a victor. And so what I want to do is go back through this thing and want you to see what maybe you don't see at first. As he's going into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday, he's got one thing in mind, and that is to go to the temple. The temple where people, men, theological men, have removed God's house of prayer and made it a den of robbers, and he goes into the temple to cleanse it, to take it over, to remind one what's supposed to happen in the temple. As he begins to teach, the Bible tells us that little children start to praise him. "Hosanna to the Son of David." Even infants are praising him. Jesus begins to heal the sick, preach the gospel, and people's lives are radically being changed because, you see, that's what's supposed to happen in church. That's what happens when men get out of the way and allow the Spirit of God to do what the Spirit of God is supposed to do. Last night, as Jesus is walking out, as Jesus is kneeling down and washing his disciples' feet with precision, he's watching an enemy. He's watching an enemy of that kingdom, flailing to try to control the situation, flailing to try to get something done, and Jesus is just watching as he washes his disciples' feet, as he celebrates the Lord's Supper, as he excuses Judas Iscariot to go do what it is you're going to do. He knows exactly what he's going to do. As Jesus Thursday night, is working his way to the Garden of Gethsemane. And he's talking about, don't let your hearts be troubled and don't be afraid. Because I'm going to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, you don't have to worry because I'm going to go and bring you back to that place. He's telling his disciples this, knowing that just an hour or so from then, he is going to be arrested. He knows it's going on. But it doesn't stop him from being in the now with his disciples, assuring them that the Holy Spirit is going to be the one that is going to be there for them, teach them all things, guide them into all truths, be their comforter. Jesus then does the high priestly prayer in John 17 where he prays for the disciples. He prays for you and me. Read it tonight. Read that prayer in John 17. Jesus is not praying about himself. He's praying about us. That we might be protected from the enemy. That we might wisely live in this kingdom. That as the Father is in the Son and the Son is in the Father, so we should be in them. Jesus says in John 15 that we should abide in him. That we should abide in his love. And he will abide in us. He's providing us a picture of intimacy, of relationship, of being the Father. Jesus works his way to Gethsemane. And now he says to his disciples, pray with me. And then he takes Peter, James, and John a little further. And he falls down on his face. The King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the second person of the Trinity, falls down on his face and he begins to weep. And he begins to pray, Father, if it's possible, take this cup away from me. Jesus wants no more of this. The cup that he's about to drink is not one that he thinks that he can take. And there you hear the enemy's hiss. Just maybe, I can get this Jesus to do something other than what he's supposed to do. Can you see the enemy watching this whole week going, I don't know what you're doing. You're not making much sense to me. Not my will, but thine be done. He goes back to the disciples and he finds them asleep. He realizes that he's all alone. These guys, his brothers in the faith, they not even staying awake. He is all alone in this. And I guess I just want to stop there for a second and I want to ask you, have you ever just been all alone in something? You turned around to find the people that love you and should support you and they're not? That you're being undercut by the very people that should be holding you up? Ever pray to God that you got to stop this? I don't want to experience this. I don't want it done. But his answer is, it's got to happen. But I'll be with you. It's got to happen because it's part of the plan. That you'll ever experience that Jesus has not experienced to the nth degree. Whether it's sorrow or pain or loss. Whether it's alone. Whether it's the pressure of Satan. When he says that he's got to drink it to the last drop, it's exactly what needs to happen. And now it's on. He rises up from prayer and says, it's coming. It's done. And he says to his disciples, let's go down because the betrayer is here. How does Judas betray Jesus? With a kiss. Ever been betrayed by a kiss? See, betrayal can only happen from those who love you. My enemy doesn't betray me, he just attacks me. I can only be betrayed by someone who loves me and doesn't love me but does something other than that. Hence, they betray me. Judas walks up to Jesus and kisses him. Jesus walks out to the soldiers and all those men that were there, and he says, hey, who are you looking for? We're looking for Jesus of Nazareth. And he says, I am he, and they all fall backwards. You got to know something's up when that happens. They get back up, they brush their stuff off, they pick up their shields and swords, and they go do it again, and Jesus allows himself to be arrested. See, well, I want you to realize that he's in absolute control. Peter, as I mentioned before, Peter pulls out his sword and lops off that guy's ear because he thinks it's time to fight. And Jesus says, Peter, stop. Put your sword away. Do you not know that I could call upon my heavenly Father and he would provide 12 legions of angels to help me? Do not be overwhelmed by what you see. But watch what's really happening. I know exactly what I'm doing. I know exactly what is happening. I am the son of David. I am a warrior, and I have come to fight. Genesis 3:15, God says to Satan, I'm going to put enmity between you. As Jesus is arrested, the stuff that's happening is second to what he sees behind the stuff. The spitting was no fun. The thorns were no fun. The scourging was no fun. The beatings and all of that were no fun. But if you think that's all that Jesus endured, you're missing the point. In all of it, he's got his eyes on you, and he's got his eyes on the enemy. Because he was born for one purpose. He was born to die so that you might live. And so as he endures the stuff, he is absolutely in control. Pilate says, do you not know that I have the authority to take your life or to give it back to you? And Jesus says, in the rare time that he said anything to him, you would have no authority if it hadn't been given to you by my heavenly Father. You, like the religious leaders, are simply a pawn. You're all pawns of a larger movement, a larger war that you do not understand. Are you a king? Pilate says. You are right in saying that I'm a king, and for this reason I was born, and for this reason I came into the world, that I might testify to the truth. Everyone on the side of truth listens to me. Pilate says to him as he walks out of the room, what is truth? My friends, do you, he was standing in front of the way, the truth, and the life, and if he just would have stayed there a few more minutes, he might have heard something. See, how many of us get introduced to Jesus, but we're not listening? Jesus says, he who has ears to hear, let him hear. Church is not about ritual. It's not about a checkbox. Christianity is not about, hey, I did that, and I did that, and I did that, and I did that. Christianity is a relationship with Jesus Christ, that because he loves you and you love him, hence the abiding. Jesus himself says, this is eternal life, that you might know the Father. You see, Jesus is the embodiment of the Father's love. If you want to see the Father, look at Jesus. You want to know what the Father's like? Look at Jesus. All right, it's time. All night long, the religious leaders had their false trials because no Jew was supposed to be on trial after sunset, but they had this false trial. They had tied him up and beaten him. Peter denies Jesus times. The rooster crows. He looks at him. That all begins to happen. Three times Pilate tries to set Jesus. Three times he says, I can't find anything wrong with this guy. Crucify him! Crucify him! Give us Barabbas! We want Barabbas! And if only they would have thought about what they were saying. This week I shared with you what the word Barabbas means. Bar Abbas, son of the Father. Give us the son of the Father while you crucify the son of the Father. Sometimes you don't even know what you're saying. Finally, the religious leaders pin Pilate. If you don't do what we want, we will report it to Caesar. And Pilate says, no go. I can't take that risk. Anybody who gets sent to Caesar dies, and I don't want to die. So Pilate gets out a bowl of water and washes his hands and says, his blood be upon you. He has him scourged and beaten, crown of thorns, and he marches off to the cross. I want you to realize as you watch Jesus, and I know that when you watch the movies and you watch the scenes, it is, from a human perspective, it is unbearable. But I want you to realize that Jesus is seeing beyond the stuff. He's seeing beyond the pain. He's seeing beyond it all to a purpose of why he's come. He is in a military position. He wants to crush the devil's head. He's just waiting. He's waiting. They nail him to the cross, and he hangs. And his very first words, Father, they have no clue what it is they're doing because they're being led by an enemy. Their minds and their hearts are confused. It's all a mess. Even one of the thieves on the cross has enough sense to say, hey, don't you realize he's innocent? We're dying for what we deserve, but he's innocent. Lord, here's how I hear it. Is there any chance you could remember me in your kingdom? And Jesus says, how about today? How about this very day? You'll be with me in paradise. He sees his mom, Mary, and John, and realizes that this is the last time, last day of his physical time on the earth. And he says to mom that, this is now your son. Take care of mom. Really? Where's compassion coming from with all the abuse that he has taken? Except that he is always expressing the Father's heart and his sights are on someone else. It says at the sixth hour, darkness covered the land. 6 hours, and it's really heavy. The enemy is saying, what are you doing now? What are you doing now? And all of a sudden, he begins to realize that the Father is putting all of the sins of humanity upon Jesus. For 3 hours, he is bearing the agony of humanity's sins upon himself. You think the crucifixion was tough? How about those 3 hours? As he takes upon our sins, as he takes upon their consequences, he takes upon their punishment. And at first, Satan is probably saying to himself, no, no, you can't do that because I got these people pinned. I'm the accuser. I got every one of them failing. I've got them dead to rights. You can't do that. But then he sees that he keeps heaping it on Jesus. The Father keeps heaping it on Jesus. And all of a sudden, he's seeing that Jesus is getting weaker and weaker. And now it's all right. It's a feeding frenzy. Pour it on. Right around the ninth hour, you hear Jesus say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? And not Father. Because he is feeling separation from the Father. He is feeling what hell is like. He is feeling it for us. He's taking upon himself. And Satan is going, yeah! Heap it on! What kind of plan was that? I'll just mess all them up after you're dead. Really? And at the ninth hour, Jesus says, I'm thirsty. See, he refused the drink earlier, but now he wants to be heard. So a guy runs over and gets a sponge, puts it in the vinegar, puts it in a spear, and pushes it up to Jesus, and he drinks from it. And all of a sudden, Jesus says with a loud voice, Tetelestai! And Satan goes, no! Because now his head is crushed. It's finished. What's finished? Genesis 3:15, he crushed the devil's head. How did he do it? Because Jesus sufficiently bore all humanity's sins, and so there are no more. The Greek word tetelestai is a financial term. It means the debt's paid. And by the way, he puts it in a perfect passive tense, if that means anything to you, but I'll explain it. Perfect passive tense means I reached back to the beginning of time, I reached upwards to the end of time, and I took care of every sin ever committed. It's finished. Now that's a soldier whose eyes were not only on the enemy, his eyes were on you. Want to hear some good news besides that? The last phrase from Jesus on the cross, Father, into your relationship was right with him, then my relationship is right with him because you're the only one that can make mine right. Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. I'm done. The work's been performed. Devil's head has been crushed. I'm going to ask the worship team to come up while I finish my message. Listen to me, please. When Jesus breathed his last breath, the earth shook. The temple curtain tore in two from top to bottom. And dead people. See, sometimes more happens than what the eyes see. But it appears to me that the light of the world crushed darkness. It appears that the one who holds life in his hands destroyed death. It appears to me that Jesus faithfully did what the Father wanted, and what the Father wanted was to redeem you and me. He wanted to sever any chain that connects you to that old kingdom. He wanted to cut it so that you might be born again, so that you might know him, so that you might know his love for you, that you might know who you're really supposed to be, that you might know what God's desire is for your life, that you might understand his great love for you, that you might understand that you are clothed in the blood of the Lamb, that you might understand that you are free because you know the truth and the truth sets you free. that you might know that as this born-again individual living in this kingdom, you have a lot going on that you didn't have before. The chains are gone. Jesus, on this Good Friday, is not a victim, but a victor. This is a little bit unusual for us, but on purpose, I wanted us to sing a post-message song. Would you please listen to these words and let them penetrate as you sing them?
Break every chain.
as is the tradition at Firmly Rooted, there is no offering on Good Friday. The gift is all God's to you on Good Friday, what he has done for you. But what I would like to do is have some time of prayer like Firmly Rooted has it. So listen, Kimberly is going to do some general prayers. I'm going to shut off my microphone, and I'm going to come down here on the floor, and I'm going to pray with the faith today. I don't know. All I know is where two or three gather in his name, he's in the midst of us. And he has a passion for your heart, and he wants you. And so as we close our eyes and as we bow our heads, if the Holy Spirit's tugging on you, let go of the armrest and come forward. You don't have to do anything. I'll pray. So let's do that now.
Father God, we thank you that you are indeed a good, good Father, Lord. We give you all the glory, all the honor, all the praise. Father, we thank you for this place, this sanctuary, this place where we can come on Good Friday and rest in your presence and rest in the knowledge that you sent your Son for us. We thank you that we can leave here knowing that the chains have been broken, Lord. We thank you that you make our dry bones alive, our dead bones alive, and our dead heart alive as well, Lord God. Thank you for thinking of us. Thank you for thinking of me as you sent your Son. But it's not just about us, Lord. There are so many hurting around us and in this room, Lord. Those that are struggling with illness. Illness is not of you. And in the name of Jesus, we say, be gone, illness. In the name of Jesus, be gone. Some are struggling with depression and anxiety. Depression and anxiety are not of you. So we say, in the name of Jesus, depression and anxiety, be gone. Some are struggling with despair. Despair is not of you. And in the name of Jesus, despair be gone. So many other things that we deal with, Lord, broken. We're broken. But you're our healer. And we come, we're at the stage or in our seats, handing you our broken, Lord. Handing you our broken. Knowing that you can fix it and make us whole, Lord. Lord, we lift up to you this evening a family that in a fire lost a home, a wife, and a mother, Lord God. Our hearts break for them. But we ask that as you make all things new, that you give this family a strong sense of your peace and your presence, Lord. And that if they didn't already know you, that through this tragedy and through the love that they experience from around them, Lord, they might come to know you. And if they do know you, Lord, hold them close and let them feel you holding them at this time, Lord. Lord, we thank you that we have the freedom to be here, that we have the freedom to worship in this country, Lord God. But we lift up to you the church around the world that is persecuted, the Christians around the world that have to go underground to worship you, that have to do it in hiding, Lord. We ask that through you there's a revival. God, we're asking for a revival. I'm asking that you give me and every person in this place a fire, Lord. A fire to save the lost, not by judging them, not by judging them, but by loving them to you, Lord God. Throughout this country, throughout this city, throughout our world, revival in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father, for loving me and those in this room, every person, God. Thank you for loving us enough to send your only Son to suffer in us for each of us. What it's like when our kids are sick, or the heartbreak of losing a child, Lord, and you did that for us. Thank you, God. Jesus, thank you for being that warrior, for being that victor. Thank you for enduring all that you endured with your eyes on us and your eyes on the enemy. Thank you for loving each of us enough that you can go to heaven without us. We're humbled. We're amazed. We're so grateful. Lord God, I ask that you invade through the Holy Spirit the heart of every person here, Lord. Let them feel you now. Let the words of the scriptures, the message, the songs, Lord, penetrate. Where we've put up walls, Lord, break them down. We have nothing to fear when we let you inside, Lord. For those that are questioning you, doubting you now, Lord, I thank you that you're a tender Father. I just ask that you gently nudge them to where you need them to be, Lord God. For those that are seeking, let them find you. Let them experience the joy of walking hand in hand with you, Lord God. Thank you that tonight we don't have to leave here sad, because we know the end of the story. So we ask that you be with us tonight and tomorrow. Let us be quiet while we wait. We'll wait. We'll wait expectantly. We'll wait hopefully. We'll be kind of giddy inside. Coming. You're such a good, good Father. Lord, take all the burdens that we have. Every care we lift up to you now, Lord. Give us the peace that only you can give. That peace until we come together again Sunday morning in explosive celebration. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus.
We pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. And all God's people said, amen. You may be seated. Let's rise for our closing song.
See you. Chicago. Then you look at this prisoner and say to me, son, stop fighting a fight that's already been won. I am redeemed. You set me free. So I'll shake off these heavy chains, wipe away every stain, 'cause I'm not who I used to be. I am redeemed. All my life I have been called unworthy. But when I hear you whisper, child, lift up your head, I remember, oh God, you're not done with me yet. I am redeemed. You set me free. So I'll shake off these heavy chains, wipe away every stain, 'cause I'm not who I used to be, because I don't have to be the old man inside of me. His day is long dead and gone, because I've got a new name, a new life, and I'm not the same, and a hope that'll carry me on. I am set me free. So I'll shake off these heavy chains, wipe away every stain. I'm not who I used to be. I am redeemed. You set me free. So I'll shake off these heavy chains.
God is good, and all the time. Gracious Heavenly Father, we leave this evening. I pray with the words tetelestai, it's finished, ringing in our hearts and in our minds. That this evening as we put our head to the pillow, we're reflecting at our own lives, wondering, finished. What's finished for me, Jesus? What do I get to be all done with because this world has been just nipping at me? What do I get to let go of? What chains get broken? What do I get to be set free of this Good Friday? And Father, may we right now in our hearts join Joseph of Arimathea, who was bold enough to go ask for Jesus' body. And as we wrap you, Lord Jesus, in those wrappings and lay you in a tomb, we know that this is not the end. Because it's only Friday. And Sunday's coming. In Jesus' name. Amen. Easter, we're going to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus because he is not in that for long. And so I invite you to come 10:15 on Sunday. And we're going to rock it out as we rise. I think that's what we have. So here's the benediction. 6,000 years old. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. And all God's people said, have a blessed evening.